Hello, my name is Radi from EnduroSat, and today I will speak about antennas and specifically how they are used to transmit and receive over large distances. So before we actually talk about antennas, let's consider a very simple example, a light bulb. If you imagine a light bulb being a perfect sphere, we can view it as an isotropic source. Isotropic means that it emits exactly the same way in all directions. So any observer will see exactly the same power flux from the light bulb no matter where they are. Now, this is nice if we need to illuminate the whole area, but sometimes we need more power in just a single direction, just like with car lights. So, suppose that we only need to illuminate half of the space. Then we can use a mirror and reflect all of the power going backwards and have twice as much in front of us. Notice that in doing this, we do not create any additional power. The light bulb is still emitting the same total amount of power, but now it is focused and anyone in front of us will get twice as much power density, which is, we can say, taken from the observers behind us. So, we already saw something similar in the previous section. We noticed that the power flux of the dipole antenna is not isotropic. Certain directions were getting more power flux than others, with maximum power going at 90 degree angle to the antenna. This is actually the main idea of antennas. The more we focus the power, the less total power we will need to emit in order to ensure good communication. Since in practice the receiver will usually be a satellite or a certain antenna, not the whole sky of course, we do not need to waste power and can really focus it only there. So how can we most optimally focus electromagnetic waves to get the maximum power flux in a given direction? The geometrical answer is a shape known as parabola. So the parabola is a very simple function, and this function turns out to have a very useful property. Any geometrical ray parallel to its axis of symmetry when reflected is focused in the same point, known as the focus of the parabola. This means that any wavefront which can be approximated as parallel electromagnetic rays will be gathered and focused at the same point. So, if we have a feeder, a source of electromagnetic waves, we can place it in the focus of the paraboloid, a parabola rotated around its symmetry axis, and it will reflect all the rays and point them toward the same portion of the sky. This works in the opposite way as well. If we want to gather more power coming from an antenna far away, we can use the surface of a parabola to focus all of that power towards our receiver and thus identify signals which would have otherwise been too faint to get. And this is the general idea of antenna. Focusing the available power only where it is needed in order to allow large enough power flux for the receiver and not waste the signals in undesired directions. Okay, but how do we quantify this? We can say that a light bulb with a mirror to the one side is twice more directive than a light bulb with no mirror, since the same power is focused on only half of a sphere, but this tells us nothing about general antennas. To make things more precise, we can introduce a quantity known as directive gain D, which depends on the starter spherical angles theta and phi. This quantity is simply the ratio between the power flux of our antenna and the power flux of an antenna with the same total power that emits isotropically. So in a sense, we are comparing our antenna with an isotropic one, which has no focusing at all. And this quantity depends on the direction, so it tells us how much more or how much less power we have in each given direction compared to the isotropic case. So the directive gain tells us for each direction how our antenna compares to its isotropic equivalent in terms of power, but we don't usually care about all directions, only for the one in which we actually need power. So the parameter which is most relevant is actually the maximum value of the directive gain, and this parameter is called directivity. Now, directivity is a dimensionless parameter, but in practice it is not that useful to work with in this form due to the large range of possible values. A decibel notation is much more useful and simplifies calculation a lot, as we will see later. Decibels are usually used with respect to some reference value, the most widely used such being the isotropic radiator. So you will often see dBs, which means decibels, with respect to isotropic. The definition of decibels is simply 10 times the logarithm of base 10 of the respective number, so if we have the directivity as the maximum value of the directive gain, we simply need to take its logarithm and multiply it by 10 to get its value in dBs. This is true since the directivity for an isotropic antenna is simply 1, so we have already divided by it. A very useful number to keep in mind is 3 dBs. Since 10 times logarithm base 10 of 2 is approximately 3, this means that any doubling of the directivity as a ratio corresponds to a 3 dB gain of the directivity in decibels. Equivalently, any reduction by a factor of 2 will change the sign of the logarithm and correspond to a loss of 3 dBs. So, any factor of 2 doubling or halving of the directivity corresponds to plus or minus 3 dBs. Using this number, we can define another very important characteristic, the half power beamwidth. This is the angular distance around the central maximum within which the power level is no more than twice as low as the maximum itself. So the half power beamwidth is simply the angular distance or area within which our directive gain is within 3 dBs of the maximum. This tells us how steep our central maximum is and is another indicator of how well we should direct our antenna. So here you can see a typical directive diagram of an antenna. You can see a central spike, which in this case is about 17 dBs, as well as two secondary spikes further away. Usually the highest spikes, the one containing the highest directive gain value, is called the main lobe. It holds most of the total power of the antenna, while the lower spikes are called secondary lobes. You can see on this plot that the secondary lobes are already much lower than the main one. They spike around 1-2 dBs. Now this is just a two-dimensional cross-section only by the angle theta, while the full directive gain is a function of both angles. So here is what the plot looks like in the 3D case. You can clearly see the main lobe, which we also saw on the 2D plot, and you can see that the full pattern is not exactly symmetrical. Some secondary lobes are higher in certain directions, but if you look at the label, you will realize that they are all very faint. The sections in green are already as low as minus 9 dBs, so indeed most of the power is focused very nicely within the main lobe. Just as an example, if we consider the 15 dBs directivity of the antenna, we just saw inverting the logarithm by raising 10 to the power of 15 tenths, we easily get that the actual ratio between the directivity of our antenna and the isotropic one is 31. And this makes dramatic difference in terms of the required input power, since we are emitting 31 times more power in this specific direction than we would have if we had not focused anything. So, the directivity of an antenna can also be given through a quantity called effective area. Aperture antennas have some area, for example the area of a parabola used to reflect the light rays. But this area is not utilized within 100% efficiency, so the notion of effective area arises. Furthermore, antennas which do not have physical area, like whip antennas, also have a defined effective area which can be used in this equation. Depending on what losses are considered, this formula may be giving the gain or the directivity. The gain is simply the directivity times the ohmic losses, while the directivity includes losses due to geometry and standing waves but does not take into account ohmic such. We will deal with this later. Intuitively, it's clear that the larger the antenna is, the higher its gain will be, as it will focus electromagnetic waves from a larger area. But why do we have a dependence on the wavelength as well? Well, the wavelength gives us a characteristic size, and the smaller it is, the larger the antenna would seem to the electromagnetic waves. So on this illustration, the waves on the left have a larger wavelength, so the antenna would seem smaller to them, while the waves on the right have a shorter wavelength and the area would seem larger to them. This is a crude intuitive explanation, but it is also meaningful in the sense that to form a dimensionless quantity like the directivity, we must divide the area of the antenna to something which also has the dimensionality of area, and lambda squared is the only possibility.